So here's a good question a student asked. In his preliminary research proposal, he wanted to do something quantitative, like a survey study. But now he's thinking perhaps he should do something more qualitative, perhaps an interview-based study, because he has a small sample of experts in the field. So, should he switch from a quantitative research design to a qualitative one for his bachelor's thesis? Let's talk about that in this video. I already have a previous video on this topic, but in this new video, let's incorporate a few additional considerations into our discussion on when to use a qualitative research design instead of a quantitative one. Some of these considerations are pragmatic and practical, some are more theoretical, and many of them are interlinked. So let's start. Number one, you might want to seriously consider a qualitative research design if you just can't handle statistics. This should be a very obvious and self-explanatory consideration, and this is a point I made in my previous video as well, and I got a lot of criticism for it. Some complained, how can you advise this to students? How can you suggest to students that they should use qualitative research designs for evasive purposes, for avoiding statistics? I hope no student would take your advice to heart. That was an actual comment that somebody left on my previous video. I wish I could show this comment to you, but I deleted it. I mean, that was 3 years ago, and I was rather new to YouTube. I actually bothered to delete negative comments back then. I was such a naive perfectionist then. Now, back to our topic. If your statistical skills are really very poor, then of course you should consider a qualitative research approach, because you'll have a much better chance of success. You have a much better chance of producing a better research study that way, instead of doing a quantitative study involving quantitative analyses, which you know you can't handle. In my previous video, I laid out quite a few different arguments for this point, so give it a quick watch if you want. The link is in the description down below. Number two, you should consider a qualitative research design if your research question is highly exploratory. This is a point which is not in a lot of dispute. Most researchers would agree that, generally speaking, exploratory questions are best addressed through qualitative research. So, if the research objective of your study is not to calculate the relationship or correlation between two variables, if your research objective is not to identify the causal effect of a predictor on an outcome, if your research objective is not to numerically and quantitatively measure a set of variables or constructs, then likely your research question is rather exploratory. I have another video which carefully discusses the differences between exploratory, descriptive, correlational, and causal research questions. Please watch that video if you are unsure what an exploratory question is. Exploratory questions are generally addressed qualitatively. So if your main research objective is to explore a particular subject matter and let key aspects surface, then qualitative. Number three, and this is a practical consideration. If you have a very limited sample size, perhaps you should consider a qualitative research design then. If, for whatever reason, you have access to only a small sample, which won't be able to generate a sufficient quantitative data set for proper quantitative data analysis, then maybe consider a qualitative research design. Instead of letting this small sample fit out a survey, perhaps we would do much better designing and conducting a proper qualitative interview-based study on this small sample. You might end up with a much better study. Just like the first point I made, if you can't handle statistics, do something qualitative. Well, this point regarding sample size follows the same kind of logic. If we know there is a severe limitation, we'd better avoid it, whether this limitation is in terms of sample size or in terms of data analytical capabilities. We avoid these limitations not because we're cowards who do not dare to face up to challenges. We do so in order to ensure that the study we perform is of better quality. When we can cleverly and strategically maneuver ourselves away from these limitations in the design and conduct of the research, the end product is likely going to be of better quality. And that is why I say, when it comes to designing and conducting research, stay within your comfort zone. Don't stretch yourself too thin. Number 4. Consider a qualitative research design if your research supervisor is really, really into qualitative research. This is also a point which I made in my previous video on this topic. If you are working with a research supervisor who is clearly a qualitative researcher to the extent that this person almost exclusively conducts and publishes qualitative research, then you might want to consider a qualitative approach yourself. There are many reasons for this. For example, a qualitative researcher is probably going to be more capable in supervising a qualitative research project instead of a quantitative one. So you would benefit more from this supervisor's supervision if your research methodological approach is something that he or she is familiar with, believes in, and advocates for. Having worked in higher education for 20 years, I have seen that, well, let me rephrase. I have a friend who has worked in higher education for 20 years, and he has told me that there still appears to be quite a bit of tension and disagreement and perhaps even animosity between qualitative and quantitative researchers, especially between those who are exclusively qualitative and those who are exclusively quantitative. Look, I would love to tell you that in higher education and academia, qualitative and quantitative researchers work in perfect harmony. But if I told you that, would you believe me? Finally, and most importantly, pursue a qualitative research design if you truly, genuinely enjoy it. I have a friend, and this is true. You know, sometimes when I say I have a friend who believes this or that, that's just an indirect way of saying I believe this or that. Because that particular belief or opinion might be a little bit politically incorrect, I would attribute it to an imaginary friend. But in this case, it is true. I really have a friend who just loves textual data. She is actually also pretty good with statistics, but she just loves texts and narratives and transcripts and things like that. I remember this very vividly because once she tells me that she's a big fan of the X-Files. She loves how Agent Mulder conducts his investigations and research. She thinks Agent Mulder is a great qualitative researcher because he can read people, because he rarely uses statistics and quantitative data, but rather relies on his personal judgments and instincts and intuition. She loves that. So even though this friend of mine is actually quite good with statistics, she just simply wanted to pursue a qualitative study for her thesis because that's just who she was. She was just fascinated by reading and interpreting and reinterpreting texts and narratives and transcripts. So my point is this. Every once in a while, it's just nice to be yourself and follow your heart. Alright, I think that's it for this video. I have many videos on the topic of research design and doing research, so please check them out. I'll link some of them down below. You may very well disagree with some of the arguments and suggestions I put forth in this video, and that's great. I'd love to hear what you think. So please leave your thoughts and comments down below. And if your comment is a good one, people will like it and upvote it, and everybody will see it. So leave a comment. Thanks for watching this Ranywayz random video. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.